On March 14th, 2019, Lizzo took the stage at Stubbs' backyard in Austin to a packed audience to close out the Thursday night of South by Southwest. After finishing her single, Truth Hurts, Lizzo took a moment to address the crowd of roughly 1,800 people. "I want you to know something," she said. "When I say, why men great till they gotta be great, I'm not talking about a man. I'm talking about the patriarchy." In this moment full of festival attendees and music industry insiders, Lizzo took the opportunity to give everyone a basic education and make sure that everyone understood the message of the song. It was a short moment, but it was also clear and impactful. Since she started touring as a solo artist in 2013, Lizzo has taken these moments in her concerts to make sure that audiences understand where she was coming from and what her journey was, giving context to songs like Pants Versus Dress, Humanize, My Skin, and others. As she has grown in popularity, she's learned to simplify these messages so that they can reach crowds of thousands as opposed to rooms of a couple hundred. But the underlying idea is the same. These teachable moments were not the first or last time that hip-hop, especially hip-hop concert spaces, doubled as a classroom where you could learn cultural and historical lessons. As hip-hop has continued to change and grow, so has its relationship with education. In the past decade, there has been a rise in hip-hop artists who live double lives as both educators and hip-hop musicians. Artists such as Samus, Mech Step, A.D. Carson, and Rabbi Darkside are just a small sampling of people who now occupy these dual roles, holding down positions as instructors at universities across the country while maintaining careers as hip-hop artists. In talking with these artists, I sought to explore the ways in which we can think of the hip-hop concert as a classroom. In 1990, Boogie Down Productions released their fourth album, Edutainment. KRS-One's portmanteau took Chuck D's claim that rap is Black people's CNN one step further and put into the spotlight the idea that hip-hop could serve as an educational tool as well as entertainment. And in doing so, we could course-correct the white supremacy baked into the American public school system. Of course, KRS-One was already on this path. Just 1 year earlier on the BDP album, Ghetto Music, The Blueprint of Hip-Hop, there was a song called You Must Learn. On this track, KRS-One explicitly lays out this thesis with a music video that saw him fluctuating between the street and the classroom as he lays out examples of what isn't being taught in school and why. In hip-hop, this idea has continued to grow and develop over the years. A lot of focus has been given to the idea of bringing hip-hop into the classroom in different formats. For example, New York artist Rabbi Darkside, who we will discuss further later on, once held a day job writing and recording raps about history lessons as part of a team that was using hip-hop as a way to get students to remember material necessary to pass standardized tests. In his 2012 book, Hip-Hop Culture in College Students' Lives, Emery Petschauer estimated that hip-hop had been formalized in the curricula of over 100 universities across the U.S. and noted that in a couple of select schools, you could now major in hip-hop. While this is all fascinating, the majority of the focus up to this point has been on the students, how they learn in the classroom, how they bring hip-hop culture into educational institutions, and the social interactions that this creates. What about the more recent trend of professors who are also working as hip-hop artists? And how does being an instructor affect their art? In concert, the teachable moments that were originally put on wax can get stretched out, and artists can use their time on stage in between songs to engage with the audience and pick these moments to explain things on a deeper level with concert goers. Many times, these people come from a different background as the artists and do not share these lived-in cultural experiences. One such artist who excels at this skill set is Samus, aka Enongo Lumumba Kasongo, who received her PhD from Cornell in 2019 in Science and Technology Studies. She is currently working at a postdoc position in the music department at Brown University, where she is teaching courses on hip-hop songwriting and feminist recording practices. Her music career and educational career were things that she initially tried to keep separate, but as she continued down both paths, she soon saw that this could be a two-lane street. It wasn't just about bringing hip-hop into the classroom to spice things up and reach kids on their level. It was also about using her classroom experience to make her a better performer. Samus grew up a dark-skinned black girl, the daughter of African immigrants, in Ithaca, a town where African Americans make up about 6 to 7% of the population. Over the course of her career, whether she was performing a show in Ithaca while she was in grad school, or at festivals like South by Southwest in Austin, she would often find herself in front of audiences that were majority white. They didn't have the shared lived-in cultural experience with her when she performs a song like Perfect Dark, which deals with the subject matter of the lack of representation of black women in cartoons and video games, and the mental and emotional damage that did to her as she grew up. Much like she might give framing notes to set up a reading or screening in the classroom to get people to pay attention to certain aspects that they should be learning, Samus will take the time in concert to put a song like this in context so that the audience can fully appreciate where the song comes from and empathize with music on a deeper level.
And a lot of people have asked me, why did you pick the name Samus? I mean, you're not an intergalactic bounty hunter. You're not blonde. You're not white. Like, what the fuck? So, all of which are true. So, I said, you know, the reason why I picked the name Samus is because she's kind of the ultimate example of never judging a book by its cover. Because you play that game, she's in this androgynous metal suit, get to the end of the game, and oh shit, it's a female. And that happens a lot of the time for me. I'll produce beats and people don't know it's a chick behind the boards. So I thought it makes sense. So that's a little bit of an explanation. So hey, I wasn't expecting that. Awesome. So speaking of me not being white, while we're on the subject, the next song I'm going to perform for you guys is a track I actually made for a mixtape that just recently came out called the Not a Nerdcore Mixtape. And it's about how, as a kid, I didn't see a lot of faces that represented me in cartoons and video games, comic books, and how it really started to mess with me. So I'm glad we're getting a little bit more representation now, but as a kid, it was fucked up. So the track is called Perfect Dark, because I mean, oh, all right. And the production is actually from a Castlevania tape that I worked on with Mega Ran. I produced the beat, and you can listen to it on our album that we did together this past April, but I'm rapping something else over it today. So enjoy. Yay! Yeah. Black girls wanna have a hero too. All kids trying to get the mirror view. Cartoons gotta represent my cue. It got our doctors sick, they want the therapy. Hey.
Sometimes the setting can be key. Marco Cervantes is Associate Professor of Mexican American Studies at the University of Texas San Antonio, and also works as an MC under the name MexStep as part of the group Third Root. As an educator, he's done a lot of work to develop college and high school curriculums in Texas to reinsert Mexican American history and culture into the classroom. But he also understands that bringing those same history lessons into the hip-hop concert setting allows him to reach and engage with people in a way that he can't always do in a classroom. Sometimes there's these bridges you're able to cross, he said, a way that you can interact with each other. There's no way I would have been able to tap into that person's consciousness by lecture alone. To the music, when it's jamming, that's the hook that gets people, said Cervantes. And then you start talking about the different realities and issues and problems and trying to really bring about some improvement. If I have the right beat, the right flow, the right hook, you're going to get this. It's rewarding to put a story together, throw some history down, and I think it's a great way to educate through art. A.D. Carson holds the position of Assistant Professor of Hip-Hop and the Global South at the University of Virginia in Charlottesville. As his career has progressed, he's continued to blur the lines between classroom and concert setting. One thing that most professors that work in hip-hop can agree on is that one of the most important skills from the classroom that they can take into the hip-hop concert setting is reading the room and knowing when to push the audience harder or knowing when to let a moment land. Carson studied at Clemson University And while there, he wrote a song about reckoning with the history of slavery on campus called Talking to Ghosts. The song ends with the music fading out and a clip from the 2013 film 12 Years a Slave fading in. Specifically, the audio is from the scene where Solomon Northrup is being whipped and told that he is no longer a free man, he is now a slave. Carson started at UVA in 2017 when a Unite the Right rally brought in white supremacists to the city on August 11th and 12th to protest the removal of statue of Robert E. Lee. In the wake of this moment, Carson played a show in the basement of a venue in Charlottesville called The Southern. As Carson got to the middle of the set, he started in with Talking to Ghosts, and in doing so, he had a quick decision to make. He could cut this outro off and move on to the next song without missing a beat, or he could let it play out. Playing before an all-white audience, Carson read the moment and decided it was important to leave it in. In the immediate moment, the show came to a screeching halt, and the audience was completely silent as they were confronted with the contents of this audio clip, with no beats or rhymes to groove to. Not wanting to lose the audience or the lesson, Carson then freestyled an explanation, much like he would improvise in the classroom, and fostered some understanding about the subject material of the song and the clip that they just heard. New York MC, producer, and DJ Rabbi Darkside, aka Samuel Sellers, currently teaches courses such as hip-hop pedagogy and practice at the New School. By his estimates, we are now in phase 4.0 of hip-hop education, where the professor slash artist is starting to become commonplace. In his point of view, it comes down to the idea of the organic intellectual, people who teach what they do and have the capacity to be self-investigative and have a critical lens you can turn on yourself. Hip-hop arts education has existed for about 20 years, so he sees it as a logical progression that you can get a degree in hip-hop education or go to a school like Berklee School of Music and get a degree as an MC or a DJ. In the previous phase, you had professors who were intellectually curious and would subject themselves to training. For example, if you're writing about the history of DJing, you would take classes to learn about scratching and mixing to get a better understanding of the subject material. In the current phase, we've got people who do the thing, teaching the thing. Darkside also sees the value in the back and forth between the two spheres and sees how teaching has helped him use his critical thinking skills to become a better MC. In December of 2019, he released an EP called A Skeleton at a Typewriter, which features a song called Ayo White Folks. The song, which is about creating conversations about race between white people, was actually workshopped with his students in the classroom. The assignment for his students was to write a song about a social justice issue, and he used this song as an example for them. The feedback in that moment helped him sharpen the lyrics and add a second verse that helped him communicate the issue more clearly.
So this is a call to action to my white folks who are combatants, the criminalizing of blackness and politicians blacking and how to kill a black man and get promoted to captain. There are a few ways you can take action. Have difficult conversations with people you need to care about. See a racist in public, call them out and stare them down. Show up for collective action, slap a plow or a yak. Film police, use your voice to speak at neighborly interactions. Read intersectional books, bell hooks, and white fragility. Watch 13th, ignore calls for newborn civilities. Duty smash the pattern. Now we buy standards. If you down with that, hop a bag. Black Lives Matter. Come on, Black Lives Matter. Say it. Come on, y'all, Black Lives Matter. Y'all, Black Lives Matter. Y'all, Black Lives Matter.
You can also hear Rabbi Darkside giving homework in that song. So as hip-hop has continued to evolve, so has its relationship with education. In 2020, it's no longer just about bringing hip-hop into the classroom. What's fascinating about the current moment is that hip-hop has now been around long enough that it's traveling in the opposite direction. Professors are taking their skill from the classroom, whether it be critical thinking skills, learning how to command attention and engage participation, or just adjusting lesson plans on the fly while you're reading the room. They are taking these skills and applying them to the concert venue. In doing so, they are taking the idea of edutainment to its next phase. Thank you very much for your time.